How did you come together with the band exactly?
Oh, wow. That's an interesting story.
Yeah.
At the time in 2003, early 2003, my mom passed away. And when I lost her, a good friend of mine, who is also a friend of the bass player, Brian, called him up and, you know, I don't know, two of them talked and they were looking for another drummer. And so I just kind of came in at that right time and I went to Brian's studio in Manhattan and he said, well, can you play to, you know, like a drum machine?
Mm.
I said, sure, I've done that before in other groups that I've worked with.
Mm-hmm.
And so that, you know, he had a little snare, he had a snare drum, a bass drum, and a hi-hat set up.
Mm-hmm.
And he played a song and I played to it for like maybe 2-3 minutes and he was like, okay, you got the gig. It was that simple.
It's not hard to get, it's not hard to be part of Public Enemy, is it?
Well, I mean, it took a little, maybe that first week, we went to London, we did some dates, and, you know, I had to feel everybody out, they had to feel me out, and it worked out.
I might try a beatbox.
Projects. I'm working with a gospel friend of mine, actually, from high school.
Yeah.
He has a CD release party coming in March, and we're going back on the road, I think, in April. So it kind of coincides just in time. And a lot of just local work, playing in clubs and, you know, getting the phone calls to do this one or that one and that
different
kind of
gigs.
Thing. Oh, yeah.
How did you begin as a musician?
Going back to childhood, it was just one of those things where, you know, I always tell people it's a gift from God.
Yeah.
I started beating on pots and pans at like 6 and went to music school actually at the age of 7
mm-hmm.
to play guitar for 2 years. And upon seeing, we did a recital and there were 3 guys in the recital. We played guitar, but then there were 3 guys playing drums. And my mother saw my eyes light up when I saw these 3 drummers playing at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
And from then on, it was like, forget it, you know? And just started playing drums formally at the age of 9. And got my first gig at 13, actually getting paid, professional reading, and all of that, so.
Wow. Yeah. Sounds like the 20s.
Yeah, I know. And went to, you know, pretty well-known high school in New York, Music and Art
mm-hmm.
High School. Went mm-hmm. there and didn't graduate.
Mm-hmm.
Did too much running around in the streets back in those days.
Yeah.
Then ended up going to Berklee College of Music
mm-hmm.
in Boston.
Mm-hmm.
And that was the best experience for me because that gave me a chance to play a lot of
different
genres of music.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Behind a tap dancer. I did a rock and roll party
mm-hmm.
at Harvard,
yeah, sure.
of all places.
Yeah.
You know, and just the local scene playing jazz with guys at Berklee and,
mm-hmm.
and playing funk and all those kinds of things. So I got a vast array. And I've always loved just music. I don't categorize music. If it's good, it's good.
Yeah.
You know, one thing about playing with PE, we've gotten the chance to play with Stanley Clarke in Philly.
Yeah, he told me actually about that, Stanley. I met him a few months ago.
Fantastic. I was elated.
Yeah.
I mean, I grew up listening to this guy,
yeah.
and now here I am on stage playing
yeah.
with him. I mean, who could ask for anything more?
Yeah.
You know, and then Archie Shepp in Paris
mm-hmm.
was another one.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and even though we're not getting into the things that some of these guys, their genres, they're kind of coming into our zone,
yeah.
you know, playing hip-hop, but it's still that you see how different genres of music kind of merge and how hip-hop is jazz, and jazz is hip-hop, and so forth, you know what I mean? So it's great.
Jazz-wise, how much was the jazz, how much did you get involved with jazz during Berklee times or in your childhood times? Did that begin earlier than Berklee?
I think so, to a degree. I mean, I grew up mostly listening to R&B, of course, Motown, Beatles.
Mm-hmm.
My dad was a songwriter.
Yeah.
And a good friend of his was a piano player. They did a lot of writing for people like, I don't know if you know who Baby Washington was.
I think so.
She had a little hit back in the day, I think back
in the 50s. Baby Washington is B-A-B-E.
B-A-B-Y.
B-A-B-Y.
B-A-B-Y. Yeah, Baby Washington.
Mm-hmm.
I think she had a song called That's What Heartaches Are Made Of,
yeah.
or something like that. My dad actually wrote the lyrics for that song. Yeah. So, not as much influence with jazz until I think I got to Berklee.
Yeah.
When I got to Berklee, I did listen to jazz on the radio, but I had an actual chance to play more of it by being in school with a good friend of mine by the name of Mark Ledford,
mm-hmm.
who's passed now, but he did several recordings with Pat Metheny.
Oh, yeah.
Also with Steve Winwood
mm-hmm.
And a couple other people, phenomenal musicians.
Yeah,
and so we would go to places like Dorchester
mm-hmm.
and, you know, the rough neighborhoods
mm-hmm.
of Boston
mm-hmm.
and do gigs every weekend. And he would like almost like force me to kind of like play those up-tempo,
yeah,
you know, straight no chaser,
yeah,
you know, type of songs, yeah. and it kind of got me more into that feel. But I don't consider myself a jazz drummer. I mean, Terry Lynn Carrington was at Berkeley when I was there, Jeff Watts, and those guys. So those are real jazz players,
yeah,
you know, to me. They always called me the fun guy when I was at Berkeley, so that was my strong point, was playing grooves and that thing. So I think it adds well to what I'm doing now, kind of, you know. Yeah. So
but I could easily see you doing jazz, or is it?
It's not my forte. No. I mean, I think everybody has their, you know, their strength, and some guys can maybe be all around. I think I have the feel for the music, but as far as it being something that I could really go and maybe take gigs in New York and be in a little small jazz club where there are predominantly these guys who are, you know, straight hardcore, like Wynton Marsalis type jazz players, I don't think I'd be as strong of a drummer as other guys. But
well, you'd probably not feel so at home there.
Yeah.
That's maybe.
So, and that's okay, because that's, you know, it's not what I do. So.
Yeah. And any particular jazz musicians that stand out for you?
Over the years, of course, Miles. Definitely. Wayne Shorter. I grew up listening to a lot of Return to Forever with Chick Corea and Lenny White and those guys. Just jazz itself. I mean, it's great music. At home, I listen to a local station called BGO, which is out of Newark, New Jersey. And that's all I listen to. Basically, I mean, I don't like, you know, a lot of the stuff that's being played on the radio. Hip hop is just garbage to me these days. You know,
damaged,
so,
isn't it?
Yeah,
it damaged goods.
Very, very much so. You know, you don't hear the things that, you know, PE stands for on the radio anymore. So,
PE was a disturbance.
Yeah.
They were disturbing the peace,
yes,
as Griff would say.
That's right. So, but just all jazz. My aunt sang jazz. So music kind of is in my family, from gospel to jazz. My aunt sang with Thad Jones and Mel Lewis's big band for some years, and was in the play Black and Blue. So she... you know, that influence kind of was there, I think, just to be in music. Just jazz itself, I just love the music. I love all music. So, you know, I think because of just like I mentioned before, being able to have somebody like an Archie Shepp or somebody like a Stanley Clarke come up on stage, that adds a whole new dimension to what you can say is just hip hop.
Yeah.
And the fact that we go into little things sometimes, we do little reggae things or, you know, Chuck gives us that freedom to kind of feel things. I think one time we were playing, and he said, do a little jazz thing. And at the time, I was trying to think of this little Max Roach lick that I had years ago. And I didn't do it, but it was just, that's just kind of, you know, giving you an insight as to as to where we go
how
musically.
How flexible you can be.
Yes, exactly. So it's not, no, there were no personal challenges at all. And as far as coming from playing to a drum machine, that was easy, because I had played with a group called Loose Ends from London.
They made some good, very good music
in
their time.
Yes, they did. Yeah. I toured with them for a while, so I had to play to an old 808 drum machine.
Wow.
And I've done it even previously. And I grew up playing the records, so you kind of learn how to play along, you know, with a beat that's there already.
Sure.
But no personal challenges at all. It was great.
Yeah. It's interesting you mentioned Max Roach, because he just passed away a few years ago.
Yes, he did.
Was he very... did you listen a lot to his music?
Oh, yes. Yeah. Him, Elvin, with Coltrane, him all the time. Those are some of my favorite drummers.
Yeah.
Art Blakey.
Yeah.
And a lot of the fusion drummers, Lenny White, Billy Cobham, Dennis Chambers.
Tony Williams.
Omar King, Tony Williams, yes. Me and Kyrie talk about Tony Williams all the time with Lifetime. I grew up listening to all that crazy stuff. I call it crazy because it was just so innovative and those drummers were so forceful, and I'd go home and listen to their records and try to imitate what they were doing, you know.
heavy characters.
Oh yeah, definitely.
I mean, Elvin Jones was a heavy character anyway.
I had the pleasure of meeting him one time, which was like, whoa. I was in a drum store, and there he was, and I was just like, wow, Elvin, one of the nicest people in the world you ever want to meet. Yeah, very humble.
Yeah.
Very humble.
He had a very tough life, though.
Yes, yes. But an incredible drummer.
Yeah.